So the technician is asking which version you are using for PowerPoint presentation.
Just a minute.
Sharing cut panna screen share only cut panna.
முன்னாடி இருக்கவங்க கொஞ்சம் முன்னாடி ரெண்டு சைடு
இருக்கலாம்.
இது கொடுக்கும்போது இந்த இது அவார்டு மெடல் சார் இங்கேயும் வந்து காமிப்பாரு அங்க காமிச்சுட்டு அப்படிங்கிற அவார்டு
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Sir, I'm using a 2007 version.
Okay, no problem, sir. Put it in screen, sir. Full slides or mode.
Just a minute, just a minute.
First, you got your
F5
for full screen. Sir, first, sir, open your PowerPoint file, sir.
Sorry?
Open your PowerPoint file.
Yes, yes.
Then choose the present now options.
Yes, sir.
Then it shows the entire screen.
Entire screen?
Entire screen, yeah.
Okay.
Then in dialog box, select the screen and it will share will be enabled.
But sir,
now what you are facing, sir?
Sir, on my screen, I have seen share your entire screen. Chrome wants to share the content of your screen with me too, right?
Yes.
When I click the entire screen, I am able to see the
screen share. Yes.
Okay, correct. Correct only.
Sir. Yes, it's correct only, sir.
Sorry.
Sir, you are going to correct.
Going to?
You are in the right mode.
You are in the right
mode, sir.
Now see. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Just
now change your screen.
Just a minute.
Yeah, it's moving.
It's okay. Moving.
Okay. Just click the hide button, sir. Hide. Below the screen. Hide.
Okay.
Is it okay, sir? Now,
but ma'am, in case of stop sharing,
sir, press escape button. It was the okay. Stop sharing.
Okay. When I press the escape button, sharing is stop by default.
Stop sharing will be enabled.
Okay.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Hello. Hello.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello, sir. Are you ready, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, I will call ma'am in a minute, sir. Right?
Okay. Okay, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Very good afternoon. Am I audible?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Welcome, you are audible, ma'am. This is registrar. Shall we start the program, ma'am?
Yes, please.
Sharati Sharanam Prabhadde Sakala Karyanukula Varshini Sakala Karyanukula Varshini Sharanam Sharanam
Now I request the Dean of School of Health Sciences, Dr. N. Vasudevaraja, to bring up the topic.
Thank you. Good afternoon to all. With the blessings of our founder Dr. T. S. Avinashlingam Ayya Avargal and Amma Rajamal P. Devadas Avargal, I'm here to welcome you all for this 19th Dr. Rajamal P. Devadas Annual Oration Lecture. As we all know, Dr. Rajamal P. Devadas Annual Oration Award was instituted by Avinashlingam Education Trust Institution and Avinashlingam Institute for Home Science and Higher Education for Women, Coimbatore, to commemorate the 80th birthday of our mentor and architect of Avinashlingam Institute, Dr. Rajamal P. Devadas. I am very pleased to welcome our respected managing trustee Anna, Dr. T.S.K. Meenakshi Sundaram Anna Avargal, who has been our source of strength in all our accomplishments, without whom this event would not have been possible. My heartfelt welcome to you, Anna. It is indeed my privilege to welcome our revered Honorable Chancellor, Professor S.P. Thyagarajan, our guide in all our activities and events. Thank you, sir. So, thank you so much, sir. And I welcome you to this event. I am delighted to welcome the speaker of today's oration lecture, Dr. Renu Swar, Secretary, Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India, who will also receive the 19th Oration Award. I thank you, Madam, for accepting the invitation to be with us on this day and be the speaker of today's event. With great happiness, I welcome you on this occasion. I am very happy to welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor Dr. Premodi Vijayan, who has been our motivation in all our actions and undertakings. She has been the force behind the successful conduct of the event. I welcome you, Madam. I am glad to welcome Dr. Gauri Ramakrishnan, Assistant Managing Trustee, Sri Avinashalingam Education Trust, to the event. I welcome you, Madam. I welcome our Dynamic Registrar, Dr. S. Kausalya, who has been actively encouraging and leading us throughout. I welcome you, Madam. On this occasion, I take this opportunity to welcome all the deans of all schools, Controller of Examination, Director of Research and Consultancy, HODs of the department, teachers, all my dear students and friends from the press and media persons to this event. I welcome you all once again. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam. I would like to invite the Assistant Managing Trustee of Sri Avinashalingam Education Trust Institutions, Dr. Gauri Ramakrishnan, to speak about the award.
Respected dignitaries on and off the dais, and my beloved teaching and non-teaching staff members, and viewers of this meeting. Good afternoon to everybody. It's my proud privilege to have this opportunity of presenting a brief report about Dr. Rajamar P. Devadas Annual Oration Award and about the today's awardee, the dynamic personality, Dr. Renu Swar. About the award, Dr. Rajamar P. Devadas, a well-known educationist and nutrition scientist of international repute, spared no efforts to place the Avinashalingam Institution on the world map. Dr. Rajamar P. Devadas served the institution in various capacities as principal, vice chancellor, and chancellor. A leading nutritionist of international reputation, she received her PhD degree from Ohio State University, USA, with copious honors in 1950, and a postdoctoral DSA degree from the University of Madras in 1978. Dr. Devadas holds several celebrity positions as Chief Home Economist and Joint Director, Directorate of Extension, Ministry of Food and Agriculture, Government of India, and Assistant Director General, ICAR. She also served with immense merit as the President of the Nutrition Society of India, President, Home Science Association of India for 2 terms, the Regional Vice President of the International Federation for Women in Agriculture, Regional Coordinator for Research, World Alliance for Breastfeeding, and the first Vice President of the World Food Conference, convened by the FAO in 1970 at Holland. Dr. Devadas' major scientific contributions embrace nutrition consultation in the colossal statewide nutritious movement program of the Government of Tamil Nadu. Dr. Devadas' Oration Award is given every year to a professional who has made noteworthy contributions in the field of home science, nutrition, and medical allied sciences. The members of the Avinashalingam Education Trust are proud to announce the 19th Dr. Rajamar P. Devadas Oration to be delivered on 7th April 2021 by Dr. Renu Swarup, Secretary, Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India, New Delhi. Dr. Renu Swarup is Secretary, Department of Biotechnology, Government of India, with effect from 10th April 2018. Currently, Dr. Swarup is also a Managing Director of Biotechnology Industry Research Assistance Council, a public company that promotes innovative research in biotechnology with a special focus on startups and small and medium enterprises. At DBT, Dr. Swarup was part of several initiatives. As a science manager, she worked on policy planning and implementation. She also heads the National Bioresource Development Board and is involved in development, funding and monitoring of programs in the area of energy biosciences, bioresource development and utilization, and plant biotechnology, tissue culture and other biomass associated programs. She was also instrumental in the formation of the first biotechnology vision in 2001, the National Biotechnology Development Strategy in 2007, and the second strategy in the year 2015. Dr. Rainsford has been a fervent supporter of women scientists and has been closely involved in several initiatives related to women and science. She is credited with initiating the Biotechnology Career Advancement for Women Scientists, a DBT scheme. She was also a member of the Task Force on Women in Science, constituted by the Scientific Advisory Committee to the Prime Minister. Over the years, she has been the winner of several awards and honors, including the BioSpectrum Person of the Year Award in 2012 and National Entrepreneurship Award in 2017. Dr. Rameswarup will be receiving the 19th Dr. Rajamurthy Devadas Annual Evolution Award on 7th April, today, 2021, at the National Institute for Home Science and Higher Education for Women Coimbatore for her illustrious contributions in the field of health, science and technology, and her involvement in promoting the welfare of the society. Thank you very much.
To the best, our managing trustee, Anna Abadal, to present the annual evolution award.
Camera. Hi, Chukumar.
Illustrious personalities of the dais, our today's chief guest, eminent scientist, Dr. Rameswarup, madam, all my sisters and brothers, good afternoon. It's a great honor for the Avinash Lingam Education Trust Institutions and Avinash Lingam Institute for Home Science and Higher Education for Women, Coimbatore, to have virtually with us Dr. Rameswarup, Secretary, Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India, New Delhi, to deliver the online 19th Dr. Rajamurthy Devadas Annual Oration Lecture instituted to commemorate the 80th birthday of Dr. Rajamurthy Devadas today on a very relevant topic, new and emerging technologies for food and nutritional security. On this occasion, I am really honored to request Dr. T.S.K. Meenachandram Anna Avargal, Managing Trustee, to virtually present the 19th Dr. Rajamurthy Devadas Annual Oration Award to Dr. Rameswarup, Secretary, Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India, New Delhi. Thank you. Thank you, madam. I'm the managing trustee of the National Education Trust Institutions, Dr. T.S.K. Meenachandram Anna Avargal, to present the award to the teachers and to the president.
Good afternoon to all the dignitaries, respected Chancellor, Professor S.P. Tyagarajan, recipient of the award, Honorable Secretary, Dr. Rameswarup, Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India, New Delhi. Vice Chancellor Dr. Premavari Vidya, Registrar Dr. S. Kausalya, Assistant Managing Secretary Gauri Ramakrishnan, Deans of various schools, Trust members, HODs of all the Department, Special Ladies Friends, Well Wishes, and our own scholars and students. Dr. Rajamal P. Devadas 18th Birthday Annual Foundation Award was instituted in the year 1999 by the Avanasani Education Trust Institution and Avanasani Institute for Home Science and Higher Education for Women to commemorate the 18th birthday of our Amma Avargal. We fondly cherish the memories of our association with her, and as a mark of our gratitude towards our Amma Avargal's contribution to the growth of our institution as a mentor and architect. Today, we have assembled here to honor Dr. Renu Surab, Secretary, Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India, New Delhi. She is highly respected in academic society for representing a perfect combination of science and technology on one side and a very progressive outlook in the profession on the other. For any successful economy, particularly in today's quest for knowledge-based health, food, and nutritional sciences, technology and engineering are the basic requisites. If nations do not implement science and technology, then the chances of getting them developed becomes minimal, and thus could be even rated as an undeveloped nation. Science and technology is associated in all means with modernity, and it is an essential tool for rapid national development. From the lips of our Amma Avargal, we learn that a woman is the powerful person for healthy social changes. Womanhood is an evolving reality of qualities and drives, dreams and visions. Women also play a great role in the growth and development of society and making it an advanced and modern nation. Amma's life has been a life of devotion and dedication to national development, particularly in the field of women's education, home science and nutrition. Health and nutrition are the most important contributory factors for human resource development in the country. At this juncture, we will gather here for the 19th Dr. Rajamal P. Devadas annual oration on Amma's second birthday to help our faculty, students, administrators, and the staff of our institution to work with dedication in the path shown by Amma Avargal to uphold the institution to greater heights and sustain the goals of higher education, human empowerment, its spiritual values. Thank you. Honorable presenter.
Thank you. Honorable President, our respected Chancellor, Professor S. P. Rajaraju, to deliver the presentation to us.
Most respected chief guest of today, Dr. Renu Surab, Secretary, Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India, and the orator of today for delivering the 19th Dr. Rajamal P. Devadas 80th birthday annual oration. Respected Managing Trustee Dr. T.S.K. Meenakshi Sundaram, respected Vice Chancellor Dr. Premavati Vijayan, the other trustees of the Avinashalingam Trust Institutions, dignitaries on the dais, off the dais, my dear faculty members and students. It's a red letter day today, because when I requested Madam Renu Surab over telephone regarding their willingness for delivering this oration, she has been so kind enough to accept it, and today she is here in the middle of several kind of commitments and others that shows her own inclination to support the women in science. That is because she is also in the Honorable Prime Minister Scientific Advisory Committee, which is working as a task force method in women and science. Dr. Renu Surab is a proactive scientist to bring in biotechnology to the forefront the initiator of biotechnology career advancement for women scientists, biocare, the DBT scheme. She is also the initiator of the BIRAC program, which is the brainchild, and it has now flourished in a very big way across the country. And in fact, it is because of that particular program today we have indigenous diagnostic kits for COVID diagnosis in this particular country. So such is the greatness of this person who has been awarded with several awards. And for want of time, I'm cutting short my talk by only putting before her our own appreciation and thanks for the science technology innovation policy of the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, in which she has been a part of it, which has been released on the 14th December 2020. I will just highlight only two parts of it, which will be very relevant to our own Avinashalingam University, which is one of the premier women universities in this country and contributing to all schemes of higher education and science. This particular policy, I quote, will promote technology self-reliance and indigenization to achieve a larger pool of Atmanirbhar Bharat, a two-way approach of indigenous development of technology as well as technology indigenization will be adopted and focused upon in alignment with the national priorities like sustainability and social benefit and resources. More especially, it also talks about equity and inclusion charter, which will be developed for tackling all forms of discrimination, exclusion, and inequalities in science, technology, and innovation, leading to the development of an institutional mechanism. An inclusive culture will be facilitated through equal opportunity for women, along with candidates from rural, remote areas, marginalized communities, differently abled individuals, including Divyangjans, irrespective of their social economic background, proportionate representation of women in selection and evaluation committees, addressing of ageism related issues, and consideration of experienced women scientists for leadership roles and regular dental and social audits in academic and professional organizations. The reason why I have highlighted this point before Honorable Madam Secretary is that this university, which is a premier women university, has been in the forefront in catering to the needs of socioeconomically backward children of the nearby rural areas. Over 8,000 students, girl students, are studying in this particular institution, and we are trying to highlight and cater to their needs. The most recent initiative that we have taken is to set up a bionest incubator in this particular institution, and we will be, in fact, be greatly honored if our initiative is also supported, because this is going to be the only women university which is going to be entering into establishment of bionest bio incubator. Thank you very much, Madam, once again for having agreed to deliver this particular honor. Thank you so much, and it is very befitting. The title of New and Emerging Technologies for Food and Nutritional Security is an important area where Avinashalingam University has contributed a lot, especially by Dr. Rajam Maldevadas. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable words. Honorable Madam Secretary, and Honorable Secretary of the Department of Biotechnology, Government of India, Dr. Vinay Suri, Director of Planning and Education Director.
Mera presentation share karo. Thank you very much, the Honorable Chancellor, the Vice Chancellor, the trustees, the registrar, the faculty. Just a minute, I'm just sharing my presentation. Usko bhi dikhao na mujhe apna. Are my slides visible? Can you see my presentation? Are my slides visible to you?
Slides not yet shared. Yes, ma'am. Now we are able to see. Yes.
You can see my slides?
Yes, first slide we can see. Thank you. Thank you, madam.
Thank you so much. So to the Honorable Chancellor, to the Vice Chancellor, to the Registrar, faculty, everybody, students, researchers, all the women scientists were there. It's indeed a pleasure to be here with you today. It's a great honor for me. And I would like to especially thank the Chancellor and all the trustees to have me here for a very, very prestigious oration lecture and Dr. Rajmal P. Devdas' birthday oration lecture. I know that your previous oration lecture awardees have been all eminent personalities, and I'm particularly very pleased that Dr. Swaminathan has been one of the past recipients. The person who inspires all of us, not just for food and nutrition, but for women scientists research as well. I think in your talk that you have just spoken about Dr. Rajmal P. Devdas, the great work that she has done, the recipient of so many awards, being really a key leader for bringing out the nutrition science and for the Avinash Lingam University, which is the University for Home Science for Women, bringing this oration lecture in her memory as a tribute to her, I think is a wonderful gesture that you all have done. And as I said once again, it's indeed a great pleasure and an honor for me. I'm truly humbled with this to receive this from you today. I'm also very, very pleased to see that the university is putting in so much of effort to facilitate the women scientists, their research. And I'm told that you have also been ranked on the Atal ranking recently, the ARIA ranking of 2020, as the first ranking for special category for the higher education institutions for women. So congratulations to all of you. And this is something which really deserves a big congratulations, because you've been able to bring the women scientists and Special University for Women to a level that receives this recognition. I have today put together a presentation for all of you, and as the title of my talk says, I thought it's important that I speak to you about new and emerging technologies for food and nutritional security. All of you through the home sciences work are doing a lot in taking the nutritional status ahead. But it's important, as a tribute to the great dignitary to whom this whole lecture is dedicated, that we bring out what is the research and innovation that really contributes to this. And that is really what I have put out in this presentation of mine. So it's important for you to understand, where does this whole nutritional security issue stand in today's context? It's been something of importance as we move along, but in today, when we are talking about the sustainable development goals, the sustainable development goal number 2 also talks about zero hunger. It talks about ending all forms of hunger, ending all forms of malnutrition by 2030, making sure that all the people, especially children, have access to sufficient and nutritious food all around the year. And there it is important that we look at new technologies, look at new interventions which can make this happen. How do we look at sustainable agricultural practices? How do we look at involving the small-scale farmers? How do we look at new research? How do we look at international partnerships? How do we look at collectively taking this as a goal forward? You all do know one thing, that if we collectively take on a responsibility, we deliver. I'll again, in fact, like to allude to the current COVID pandemic. You know that for the COVID pandemic, you've come up with wonderful S&T solutions. How have we done that? We've collectively taken that as a responsibility and delivered. Going specifically to the food and nutritional security, we all know Norman Borlaug. There was a very important statement which Norman Borlaug made, and he had said, there are no miracles in agriculture production. We talk about, and my next slide will talk about the Green Revolution. It wasn't a miracle. It was an applied mind for a proper, well thought of, strategically planned intervention. And that is really what took us to where we are today in terms of our agriculture, food, nutritional security. How did it begin? It all began because of the Bengal famine that we had in 1943. That's when we realized the importance of bringing in new technologies, bringing in self-sufficiency for our food, for our nutritional security. And of course, we had the father of our Green Revolution, and that's what I said. I was so honored that Dr. M.S. Swaminathan himself has been a recipient, and Norman Borlaug, who led the Green Revolution. What really was the Green Revolution? It was bringing in new technologies, keeping an open mind to adopt these, how they are required for our country. And we achieved what we have, and that's all before you in terms of history and in terms of the foundation to move ahead. It's also important to bring before you a very important statement, and that was by the CEO of a very important group, which he said, innovation does not always come in the form of a new product or a technology. It's also the way we have new ways of addressing the same problems. So we could have a large number of problems. So we have to find new ways, new models of implementation, new models of governance, new models of cooperation. Everything is a new innovation. So it has to be a combination of technology, of implementation, of governance, and more importantly, today where we stand, innovation in terms of our own culture of research, in terms of how are we going to move forward. So today I'll share with you the new technology interventions. There is need for continuous R&D for newer innovations. We need improved capacities in terms of human resource and infrastructure. If we're talking about new innovations, you need new infrastructure, you need human resource which caters to that. How do you do that? As I said, you need new models of partnership. Whether it's the researchers or the entrepreneurs or the industry, we need to have all of them coming together. And that's really what the Department of Biotechnology, my own department, has done over these many years. You spoke about the strategy in 2007, which I was very fortunate to be a part of, the strategy of 2015. And very recently, we have now brought out our own strategy on the 1st of March in the Global Bio India, the strategy 2020. So these are the strategies where we are focusing on these change models of partnership. Now, coming specifically to food and nutritional security in the whole area of agriculture, in the last few decades, there have been large number of technologies that we focused on, whether it's transgenics, whether it's genomics, whether it's marker-assisted selection or gene editing. Each of them has contributed to the new technology development that we move forward. Transgenics, we all know there's been a lot of work that's been done. There are certain regulatory challenges which we're trying to see how we can take it forward. There are successes in it. But I think if you look at from the nutritional security viewpoint, there have been very major achievements which have come in through the genomics research, through the marker-assisted selection research, and now, of course, through the gene editing research. The genomic initiative, India has really moved ahead. We started with rice, we then moved on to tomato, we did part of a chromosome in rice. We did again part of the chromosome in tomato, in wheat, and now we've been part of a very large network which did the wheat. In 1998 is when we became partners to the rice genome. We then took it forward, we became part of it, we moved it ahead, we achieved a lot of success. We built capacities. We became, as I said, a full chromosome, and we took on for the tomato genome sequencing. 12 countries were partners to this. And then recently, as you know, we were again partners in this whole wheat genome sequencing. So what do these genome sequencing really give us in terms of strength? It gives us an understanding of the crop. Coupled with the genomics work that we've done, we bring in the functional genomics aspect. With the functional genomics aspect, we understand what the genetic nature of each of the genes is. How do we bring out improved plant breeding? How do we bring about improved variety productions? And also, how do we take it forward for the nutritional status? You identify the specific genes and start working on them to move ahead. So as I said, early 20th century, we were focusing on physical, chemical, biological mutagenesis work. In the late 20th century, we took on to the transgenics. In the 21st century, we really have now been focusing on the gene editing. But if you look at the genomics work, it's so important for all these. Whether you're doing the transgenics, whether you're doing the gene editing, you need to have an understanding of what the genetic makeup of that particular crop is. And that's where the important tools of functional genomics and crop breeding are now being used with these tools that we have of technologies to take it forward. Gene editing, I'd like to mention that one of the first few technology transfers that we did was of a transgenic banana. And this is when our Honorable Prime Minister visited Australia. We had the Queensland technology that came in. And with this, we are now having these transgenic banana varieties which are being developed. They're in our institute, NABI at Mohali. We have the NRC banana, which is part of it. We have IHR Bangalore. We have a couple of other institutes all working closely to see how we can take it forward. Because of the paucity of time, I'm not going to give you a list of all the various crops, but along with the Indian Council of Agricultural Research, there are a large number of crops that we are working on, whether it's rice, whether it's wheat, whether it's horticultural crops like banana, maize we brought out. So that was gene editing. We then are looking at marker-assisted selection. This, what I put before you, is really an improved maize variety that came out through marker-assisted selection. We have a major program on marker-assisted selection. Very recently, the Department of Biotechnology has set up a national genomics and genotyping facility in our institute, that is the National Institute of Plant Genome Research. We've taken up the whole task of doing germplasm characterization. 63,000 accessions of germplasm are being characterized. What is the purpose? Can we develop pre-breeding material? Can we make it available to farmers so that they could identify the traits which they are interested in, whether it's nutrition, whether it's biotic and abiotic stress, and see how they can produce varieties on that. This variety that I'm talking to you is already out. We already have this maize variety which has been released. There are many more that we can do. We've also taken up special programs on underutilized crops. We've taken it up on millets. We've taken it up on a large number of legumes. Because today, the emphasis is to be on how do we look at our own germplasm? How do we start working on trying to bring either a domestication of that, or we also work in terms of increasing the uptake of those varieties? Institutes like yours play a very important role in that. Generally, we are guided by what the food habits of people are. You will see we generally do not have people getting into very easily having an uptake of some of these underutilized crops, knowing fully well that their nutritional content is very high. What do we do for that? Can we increase that through some newer products that we bring out? Do we assess what the market is in terms of the demand of the public and then develop products which meet that requirement? So for that, it's important that we first come out with some improved varieties, which our agricultural scientists do. They bring in that part of the agricultural produce. Scientists like you then look at bringing in the value addition to it in terms of the products. So I think that is really the amalgamation of different technologies to be able to take in new products for our consumption, for our consumers, to see how we can increase the nutritional status. So the Department of Biotechnology has really put together a very major mission on public health nutrition, which addresses different aspects of it. Whether it's the micronutrient deficiency, the anemia, we all know the statistics. To an audience such as this, I'm not going to list out what the statistics are. I'm not going to say it's important for us to address micronutrient deficiency. It's important for us to address the severe acute malnutrition. We need to look at how do we bring in the agri-nutrition linkages for protein malnutrition, stunting. These are all major problems with us today. We all know that there has been a Poshan Abhiyan which has been launched. The whole purpose of Poshan Abhiyan is how do we address all these issues? How do we address these public health nutrition strategies which are important for the lifestyle disorders? So it's not only for the children, it's for the adults. It's for the maternal and child health. We know how important the first 1,000 days are for the child's life cycle. How do we address that? There is a whole biology that goes around this nutrition biology. How do we, is anybody connecting those aspects of it? Are we only looking at nutrition in isolation? Or are we connecting it to the biology part of it? There is a whole analysis that goes in to say, how does the nutrition get affected? How do we connect the microbiome research to it? Very important piece of research. There is so much of data today on microbiome. Are we connecting those aspects? Of course, issues such as food safety and allergy are so very important. Probiotics, functional foods, these are all the value additions that we put in. So these are a whole lot of activities which the department is doing along with BIRAC, many of our other institutes. We have a set of autonomous institutes. And as you said, now we are looking at involving our entrepreneurs, our stakeholders, setting up incubation centers to see how we move forward. This is a whole program that we set up on addressing the iron deficiency. These are technologies which have been developed by IIT Kharagpur. It's been tested out by Dr. Kurpat in the St. John's Medical College. There are a whole lot of activities that we are putting together. How do we now try to see this technology, which is important for taking the addressing the iron deficiency, can we take it to the school children? Can we make it part of their midday meal program? So this is another activity which is being taken on. We are actually supporting a whole scientific subcommittee of the National Nutrition Mission. So they pose a lot of questions to us, which we try to find scientific solutions and connect the two to take it forward. I mentioned to you about NABI, our institute in Mohali. They have actually come out with some colored wheat varieties. You can see that the whole aim is of developing high anthocyanin varieties. They've produced them. We already have excellent physiochemical sensory parameters which have been evaluated for them. They've shown some very good antioxidant effect, anti-inflammatory effects. They've been approved by FSSAI. We've already signed up an MOU with some companies. 750 acres of this have been planted. But today, if you ask me, how many products are in the market? I'll say very few. Why is it? It's because we have not been able to bring those products which consumers will accept. Who can do that? Institutes like yours. Can you work with these institutes and organizations who produce these high-yielding varieties which do not have consumer acceptance? Come up with some value addition products which then can get market, which can get market uptake. Let me tell you, the diversity that we have in our country, we definitely can be a leader in this technology moving forward. It's just that what I started my first slide by saying, can we take up collective missions? Can we take up collective responsibilities of taking it forward? We are doing the same for our chickpea. NIPGR is producing high-yielding chickpea variety, which has 15% higher protein content. Now, will this variety not be so important when you take it to your consumers in being able to? Now, it's also important to understand, while the variety gives you 15% protein content, what is the bioavailability? How do those studies get connected? What do they actually translate into when the products are developed? We also have started a major program which is called the Biotech Kisan program, in which we have created these hubs which have connected with KVKs, with farmer producer organizations, with state agriculture extension services, state agriculture universities. We've set up 115 of these in aspirational districts. As you know, aspirational districts today have a very important parameter that we look at. How do we enhance their nutritional security? Very important parameter in addition to others. Education, health, they're all parameters, but nutrition is an important parameter. It would be wonderful to see if your institute can play a very lead role connecting with our local Kisan Hub to see how you could bring in the nutrition-based technologies and take it to that aspirational district. I'll be very happy, Dr. Tyagaraj, to discuss with your people and connect you with my officer who deals with the Kisan Hub if your institute can play a major role in taking in these nutritional programs for the Biotech Kisan Hub. Technologies. Coming to the last part of my presentation, I think it's important what I've said. We have to connect research to innovation to commercialization. We need to have a complete enabling ecosystem, from financing the high-risk research to helping finding the risk capital for startups and industries to take it. Eventually, our technologies can go to the market only through industries. How do we connect those stakeholders? How do you give access to the market? Organization, which today has been able to put up a very, very strong foundation of 9 years of its existence. We support right from ideation to market. I'm glad that you are considering for a BioNest. It's wonderful because that's where you will be able to take startups, you'll be able to connect your faculty with entrepreneurial ideas to take it forward. So right from finance to mentoring to resources, the whole thing is provided by BIRAC. So what do? We connect academia with startups, with industry, across the value chain from discovery to market. What do? We empower them, we give them incubation space, we give access to research resources, they get connected to our institutes, we help in the IP and technology management. Very important. Because if you build new technologies, how are you going to license them out? You as a university cannot do that. You will need to connect with some industries. That's what we work towards. You need a regulatory ecosystem. Any product that you take out has its own regulatory requirements. How do you provide business mentorship? Many of your own faculties may want to set up their startups. We have this Golden Jubilee Biotech Park in Chennai, which is the first women biotech park. We've set up, as I'll go to the next slide to show you, many women biotech parks. They all needed business mentorship. We do provide that. So this is really our BioNest incubator scenario currently within the country. 60 of them. We've got large number of products which have been launched, a number of incubatees. Each one of them, and these are really the agri-related BioNest incubators, many of them focusing on nutritional aspects, local nutritional aspects. So you're looking at global best practices, local problems, not just for your local market, but for global market. That's really our call for Atmanirbhar Bharat. So this is really what a snapshot of some of our BioNest activities look like. And we do have a provision there of financing individuals under the big scheme. So individuals can then incorporate their own startup in the incubator and be able to set up and take forward their ideas to grants. We have a social innovation program called Sparsh. The social innovation program for affordable and relevant products for societal health. Again, nutrition plays a very, very important role in that. I think, again, here, there is something that we need to see how we'll take it forward. Women entrepreneurs, very relevant to a university like yours. More than 300 women entrepreneurs have been supported so far, not just through the BioNest. We have exclusive bio incubators. We have a TAI program. I don't know how many of you are aware of that. The TAI winner program is mainly for women in entrepreneurial research. We've just concluded a call for that. It happens each year. I'm sure many of you would want to get involved in that to take it ahead. So I'll conclude by saying This is how we create an effective pipeline. We started many, many years back when DBT came into existence, probably way back in 1986, 35 years from now, when we used to have single investigators who work on projects. We moved to multiple. We then took on multiple institutes who came forward for addressing common problems. Then came multiple agencies, whether it was DBT, DST, CSIR, ICMR, ICR. We then brought in industry. You had the academy and the industry. Today, all of them have to come together. You need a consortia approach. You need universities, you need academic institutes, you need research institutes, you need startups, you need industry, you need the policymakers, you need everyone to come, international. We've now, in fact, setting up what we call Urjit clusters, university, research, joint industry, translational clusters. It's important that your university finds its own partners, finds an important place. You have a niche area of nutrition that many do not have. There must be existing consortia which need your presence there. And that's how we need to take it forward. Whether it is going to the communities through these integrated farming systems, which again we have supported in a big way, or it's helping or working with groups who are doing adoption of technology. This technology I'm showing you, what is it? It's a domestic solar conduction dryer. Many of you will say, what is so unique in that? It's one which operates just on solar power. Today, we have hundreds of these which we have given into the aspirational districts. And data shows us that the nutritional status of the women there has increased. Very, very small innovation. Very, very small. Huge impact. We brought in digital education. That digital education is again brought in an impact. This is a very interesting story where we had farmers who came together. In fact, more than 1,300 farmers created these agri enterprises. They've been trained. We have set up these little franchisees. And what are these farmers doing? These women are cultivating vegetables in their backyards. All that we did is gave them a protocol of a mixed nutritious vegetable package. They only packed them into 1/2 kilo and 1 kilo vegetable packs. And one pack of vegetable gives you a complete nutrition for the family. That's it. What a small innovation. But the franchisees that have been set up, they go and sell these, which pick them up from the women self-help groups. And today, this is a wonderful enterprise which has enhanced the income of these women. This is in Orissa. Many such examples we've set up. We've also set up these nutrition-sensitive gardens where they've been able to understand. We brought in nutrition literacy for them. This was done with the Swaminathan Research Foundation. We set up these 5-acre plots. We gave them 100 nutri-rich biofortified plant species. It's basically, they've achieved the diet diversity score of the undernutrient. We've also seen how we could increase their farm household levels from up to 60% from the base level. This is pictures of the 4 sites. Just to show you that this is not on paper. This is actually happening on the field. This is where technologies are making an impact. So we keep talking about excellent technologies in the laboratory, but till they do not reach this level, they have not made an impact. So the last slide I would like to mention is, you need to define your problem correctly. That's what Steve Jobs said. You always have, you've nearly got your solution there. So you identify what the problem is. You would have already found your solutions from within you. You don't need to work anywhere else. So what is our problem today? Is it the technology that we have, we are lacking, or is it the implementation of those technologies? I think it's important for us to see that those technologies are appropriately implemented. Our Honorable Prime Minister had said in one of the addresses he made to the scientists and technologists, I see technology as a means to empower and as a tool that bridges the distance between hope and opportunity. So now, this is a message for all of you where I will conclude. What is our new technology revolution? We have the hope, all of us have a hope that we are going to be self-sufficient in food and nutritional security. We've developed a large number of tools. You've seen the whole plethora of tools I've brought before you. Are we going to seize this opportunity to be able to bridge that gap and use this technology for our society? This is really what I would like to present to you. I hope my slides are going to convey to you what this key message has been, and I'm sure your university will be able to take forward some of these key learnings. Thank you very much for patiently hearing me.
Respected and honorable Managing Trustee Anna, thank you very much for guiding us and for making this oration a grand success and for presenting the award and the gold medal to our chief guest man. Thank you, Anna. Thank you, respected and honorable Chancellor Sir, for guiding us right from the beginning and for all the guidance that you have given to arrive at today's function, which is a scientific feast in the name of our Amma Avargal as Varation, and for the address. Thank you very much, sir. To our Vice Chancellor Madam, who is leading us in the right path, thank you for your address and requesting our Anna to present the award. Thank you, Madam. Thank you, Assistant Managing Trustee and former Registrar Dr. Gauri Ramakrishnan, for highlighting about the Dr. Rajaman P. Devadas Award and the recipient of the award. Thank you, Madam. I am very honored and thankful to no words I get to thank our chief guest, the recipient of the prestigious 19th Dr. Rajaman P. Devadas Annual Oration Award. Let's give a big applause to Madam for the most scientific way that Madam has presented today. Thank you, Madam. Words are failing to thank you. You started your lecture by introducing Dr. M.S. Swaminathan, who is a green revolutionist and the father figure of our own institute, and our Ayya's great friend, and Dr. Rajaman P. Devadas' great friend. And I myself, as a nutrition scientist, I could see how this lecture has been really a challenging one to develop our students as entrepreneurs, to instill the new innovation ideas in the food and nutritional security as emerging technologies. So you started with Dr. M.S. Swaminathan. You took us to transgenomics, nutrigenomics or genomics per se, marketing, and also the gene editing. And you ended up with the community programs. You showed the picture of, live picture of all the incubators, incubatee, the women entrepreneurs, and the Kisan scheme. We are happy to say that our managing trustee is the chairman of the Avinashalingam KVK, the then founded by Dr. T.S. Avinashalingam Ayya Avargal. So definitely we as the faculty members and students of Avinashalingam University, and as a nutrition scientist, definitely we would like to take up research in the new frontier areas where you have shown us biofortified foods, which the sensory evaluation and other aspects will be interested. And our Chancellor has been a keen scientific leader. He is asking every day to come up with new innovations and write the project proposals. Definitely by 1 week and the other, so every week I think you are going to get a proposal from our end in one scheme or the other. And I am sure that I ensure that on behalf of all the students and faculty, definitely your help is needed, and we will strive towards the Department of Biotechnology themes and arenas that you have really given an insight. And really, once again, thank you on behalf of the Avinashriyam Education Trust and the Avinashriyam Institute for Home Science and Higher Education for Women. Thank you, madam. Hats off to you for your leadership in the country, for this field of nutrition, especially for women scientists. And we all feel that Dr. Adhimal Devadas is present here on the dais to bless each one of us, and especially the recipient of today's award in the name of our Amma Avargal. Thank you, madam. I thank the Home Science Dr. Vasuki Raja for welcoming all of us in her own way and in a very nice, warm way of welcome. Thank you, madam. I thank all the deans, directors of various schools, our finance officer, controller of examinations, assistant registrar, academic public relations officer, audit officer, computer center, all the technicians, videographers, all the faculty and research scholars, for your enthusiastic way in which you have participated in this 19th annual oration in the name of our Amma, Dr. Rajamar P. Devadas. I thank the overall conveners, Dr. Tirumani Devi and the entire Department of Food Science and Nutrition, FRM Department, and all the departments for arranging the prayer this morning and also in the auditorium. And I thank the press for the unseen hands that you are transporting the entire, you are taking the news from the media, from the institute to the community. The trust members who are our backbone for the institute, for taking us, leading us in the present way, especially doctor, who is a trust member, whose presence is very much valued, and we seek the support and guidance of all the trustees in the enduring manner in which the institution has to come up. Thank you, one and all. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, madam, once again. Jay.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much for this. Thank you.
जनगण मन अधिनायक जयते भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्कल बंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्छल जलधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मागे गाहे तव जय गाथा जनगण मंगल दायक जय हे भार भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
once again, thank you one and all for your kind attention and wishing you to us a good evening.